Welcome to the Leadership with Biana Kovic Show, and thank you for being with us. Our topic, leadership, focuses on leaders such as yourselves. We believe that leadership is a skill that can be learned through practice and awareness. It is our hope that our conversation will help you become more reflective when it comes to your own leadership practices and enable you to leave a positive legacy. Our very special guest tonight is Carlie B. Gintoli. Carlie is a Miss Florida at Miss America Pageant. She's a spokesmodel at Pacers National Bullying Prevention Center and supports a nonprofit organization called Hope for Autism. She's a representative at international face magazine called WIP, TV personality, fitness mentor, cover model, and philanthropist. Carlie, good evening and welcome to the show.
Well, thank you for having me. I have been waiting for this day, and I'm so excited that I could share some peace and joy and leadership with your show. I am so pleased that you invited me. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Carlie, you are Miss Florida. Can you a little bit tell us more about how did you get to become Miss Florida?
Well, actually, it was a process. I was always a leader when I was in high school. I was with the high school leadership club there. And then I was also the head cheerleader in all of my high school years. And how I got into the beauty pageant, I just kept getting asked to be in pageants. I'd have one director after another director ask me if I would want to be in this pageant. And it started when I was in teens. And then I also was asked to judge a lot of pageants. And I also was a professional model. So I did a lot of traveling. And then when I came back to Florida, it seems I was just asked to be doing so many, this pageant and this pageant and this pageant. Before you knew it, I was in the Miss Florida pageant and I won that. And it's just been like a series of events that have kept me on this path. Mm-hmm. And I have always been encouraged to be in pageants. And I've always, if I haven't been in a pageant, I've always asked to help in organizing a pageant. So I guess it's just people know me as being in pageants. A couple years ago, I was current Miss Northwest Florida. And everybody knew me as Miss Northwest Florida for like two or three years because I kept winning that position. So, you know, I kind of became that actual person. Everybody knows, oh, that's Miss Northwest Florida, but now she's Miss Florida. So, you know, and then I was Miss Florida State. But I've been encouraged by others, and I've always excelled in my schooling. I was always the youngest in my class, and I was always, if I took a test, I was placed in the highest class, the hardest, highest classes you could be for your age. And so I excelled pretty fast. And then when I went to college, I did too. So I guess I am a role model, and I tried to be the best I can. And through education and awareness and good positive communication, and I feel really good when I can help somebody out. They're having a problem or an issue, or if they're being bullied, or if their self-confidence is not there because they're being told they're not a good person, or, you know, whatever the circumstances. Mm-hmm. So actually, you know, I feel uplifted when I am actually helping someone else not be depressed and to move forward and to talk.
Carlie, prior to this call, we talked a lot about your support for a nonprofit work, and in particular when it comes to advocacy for anti-bullying and giving children support to deal effectively with bullying. Can you talk to us a little bit about that part of work that you do?
Yes, actually we call it Beyond Sticks and Stones, how we can help your children to overcome bullying and be aware that they're being bullied. In the past, it was accepted, you know, like 30 or 40 years ago, that bullying was okay. It was just part of going through school, and that was just the way it was. Well, that's not the facts, because studies show that bullying, and one out of five children, or I would say teenagers too, are bullied in their lifetime. And they don't have to have special needs, or they just are bullied because they might be different. So what we try to do is, through our organizations, and there's several different bullying campaigns out there, but I represent PACER.org, and I help them raise money and awareness by providing bookmarkers. And our bookmarkers are really amazing because the bookmarkers are perfect for school books. And the teens pass them out. And what the bookmark says is it says 1 out of 5 students will be bullied this year. This will probably happen to somebody you know and care about. And they actually say, would you make a commitment to support others by helping treat other people with kindness and being more accepting, include people that are left out? And actually doing this nationwide now. We've got Florida. We have 3 divisions in Florida that we are, you know, working toward opening. We've got 2 locations that are going to be in, one in Tampa and one in South Florida. And of course, I'm in Northwest Florida. But I will say this organization is based out of Minnesota, and they have been working almost 20 years. And they first started out with just dealing with children with special needs. And then it was like another snowball effect because they realized that, hey, it's not just kids with special needs. It's all different children. It can be a child that is shorter than another child, or a child that's taller than another child. It can be anything. You have brown eyes. I have blue eyes. You know, it doesn't matter what color skin you have. So we're trying to teach our next generation and the next generation to accept one another as who they are. They're special in their own way, and to be kind and courteous and respect one another. And if we can accomplish this, just think of what our society would be like. It would just be unbelievable. We probably have no crime, hardly. We probably would have so much more knowledge about even getting rid of cancer, because people would be more in tune in doing things that are positive, like studying or learning and being more creative. So, you know, if you take bullying off the table, it would change a lot of people's lives, and the positive end. It would probably result that we would be a lot more stronger individuals. We would also be more intelligent and learning about each other's differences. Instead of not liking somebody because they're different, learning about their differences so that you can learn a little bit about yourself. So it's basically spreading the news that we are individuals, and everybody wants to be treated with kindness, courteous, and nobody wants to be harassed. Now, they do have laws, too, in many states that actually you can file a case against a person that bullies a student that has a disability. I would have to go to the website to look at, I'd say that about half the United States is on that type of, that you can file an actual complaint. But, you know, you have to remember, bullying is verbal. Bullying is physical sometimes. And bullying is more harmful mentally than it is physically. And a lot of people don't understand that, you know. Because, you know, you see clips on the television of kids pushing kids into lockers and stuff like that. And I hate to say it, even television, putting that, kids see that on TV, oh, I can do that at school too. We're learning from television too. So I think possibly we should monitor our kids watching certain things on TV. That's my own personal opinion. But television does promote a lot of bullying on some of the shows. And like anything, we're taught by, you know, what we see, hear, and do, and hear a little around each day. So if we can make the parents and the caregivers and teachers more aware, and we've got plenty of books and literature, and they can go to the website, like I was saying, PACER.org, they can get so much information to help prevent this. Bullying just doesn't end. What happens if it's not treated? It's just like if you had a certain type of cancer and the cancer is spreading, mm-hmm. and you don't go to the doctor and take your medicine and do your treatments, and it finally goes away. It's a small thing, you know. And what happens is those negative messages continue to grow in that child's head until somebody corrects it. And so if nobody ever corrects it, what happens is they act out in different ways. Mm-hmm. You know, they will isolate and they will think they're not adequate and they're not accepted and, you know, around anyone. And if you isolate a child or somebody, eventually the child will do something drastic. And, you know, they might start, you know, using drugs to deal with it. They might start cutting themselves to harm themselves. Mm-hmm. So it's all awareness, and it happens every day. Mm-hmm. And it really needs to be more, you know, I will say this, breast cancer, I've been a big advocate for breast cancer for years, and I've seen people cured, and it's a, you know, wonderful miracle. And I know it's a hardship, breast cancer, but bullying is just as important as breast cancer. If it needs to be, you know, diagnosed, it needs to be corrected, and then it needs to be, you know, the person doing it needs to be talked to and say, why are you bullying that person? Mm-hmm. You know, and have a teacher conference, or needs to have some adjustments. They need to be corrected, but that is not the way that you should act. You know, mm-hmm. unfortunately, bullying is a learned act. Mm-hmm. So they watched it somewhere. They learned it somewhere.
So I really liked what you said that, you know, bullying can make a negative, long-lasting impact on the person. And that if it's not diagnosed, people can actually end up having different type of, if you want to call them, side effects from being bullied. What are the most common misconceptions when it comes to bullying?
Well, the misconception is they think that when the bullying stops, that the child is over it. And mm-hmm. that's not the way it goes. What happens is if a child is mentally bullied for a period of time, like say a year, and it's not detected, that child, it's like planting a seed in that child's brain. And it begins to grow and grow and grow. And they will start to do bad in school. They won't go to school. They'll do everything they can to avoid the situation because it's so painful mm-hmm. to, you know, be bullied or be humiliated. Now, cyberbullying is really bad, too, because what's going on with cyberbullying and technology and the internet and a cell phone, you can be harassed and hurt and embarrassed, humiliated by numerous people. Mm-hmm. There was a story of a child that was changing clothes in a locker room. Another child took the picture of the person and spread it through the internet. Mm-hmm. Now, that is detrimental to the victim. So my belief is that we do not put enough education out there. This is what's going to happen if you do something like that. You're going to have to suffer some type of consequence. You're going to have to either serve community service, or you're going to have to be put into another unique circumstances, or that whoever's doing the cyberbullying could be mentally ill themselves. Mm-hmm. So they need to be dealt with the proper educated person, whoever's going to help them stop doing the bullying. But, you know, that's pretty much the problem is, I would say, that there is not enough laws out there. I think that they should have some law enforcement that actually looks for that type of behavior mm-hmm. and sees somebody doing that. And I doubt that they do have some of that because we don't have enough restrictions. And I actually think that a child should not be able to use the internet unless the parent is right there with them. Mm-hmm. And at a certain age, you know, maybe, you know, I'm just guessing. But there's so much going on with the teenagers And, you know, they're like a whole nother galaxy than we are because they're not totally developed. So they will run away and you won't see them and they don't want to talk to you because the communication is not out there.
Mm-hmm. So I think you're bringing up an interesting point here is that if kids are not pointed in a direction that they can feel helpful or that they can use their energy to do good to others, they would actually become bullies. So what are your thoughts? What are suggestions you have for parents? How can they point their kids in a direction so that their energy is used towards more positive versus towards negative, such as bullying?
There are so many things that they can do. You can do a three-step plan to address different types of bullying. Now, if you have just like a one-on-one bullying type person, that's pretty easy to, you know, say, hey, you're going to be in this, you know, you put them in different groups, you know, to learning, like a study group. Like if they're in, you get the study groups working together and they have one answer that the whole team answers. So they have to be a unity, you know, be a union, you know, work together as a team and answer the question. So basically having interaction with small groups, that is one of the most positive ways because that way you get rid of the isolation. So if teachers wanted to do that instead of letting, you know, letting them just, you know, study on their own and the you can do study groups and then they can interact with each other and they can get to know each other. And you have rules and regulations during the study groups. And I think by those little study groups that the kids would get to know each other and then they would find, you know, that, hey, these people are really nice kids. Why am I acting ugly to them? You know, or, you know, why would I even think about that? They develop friendships is what I'm saying. And that's pretty much what, you know, bullying is about, is the person that's actually doing the bullying is insecure about themselves. Mm-hmm. So they got to pick on somebody else so that they can make themselves feel better. Well, that's really the problem right there. So if you can get all of the kids in a unity, in a group, and they're all trying to work on the same problem solving, and they work it out together, then brings a friendship and a caring about each other. So that would be my first recommendation, is to have small little study groups where nobody's left out. And, you know, that would be the biggest thing right there. And that's probably the most powerful way of preventing bullying in classroom. But and also other organizations too, like say if you take them to summer camp, you always put them in groups in summer camp. You know, this is group A, group B, group C, group D. And y'all are all going to, you know, do this and blah, blah, blah. And you keep them organized and you keep them involved and you keep them working as a team. You know, it's like if you were, you know, going to watch an opera. The opera has to work as a team and perform. So, you know, if you keep everybody in the group and performing, you're going to have an excellent, you know, presentation. Basically, that's a pretty simple, you know, answer. But that's about the, you know, the way I feel about it. So that would be what you need to do. And also there are some school safety climates. They have the National School Climate Center, which is the www.schoolclimate.org. And the goal is to provide positive information to sustain school calm climate for the students and a safe environment and a good place for them to learn their academics and their skills. So they can go to different PTA meetings and, you know, Child Advocate Association, a Parent Teacher Association. Any of these types of organizations are wonderful to get advice and help and do it locally first.
Very nice. So one more time, the organization that you're working with, it's called PACER.org, correct?
Correct. It's called PACER.org, and then it's /bullying, B-U-L-L-I-N-G.
In addition to working on anti-bullying various initiatives, you are supporting an autism organization. Can you tell us a little bit more about an autism organization that you are supporting?
Well, actually, the one I'm supporting is called Autism Serve, and it is basically for all the southern states from Louisiana to Florida. And what they do is they have the parents and the families and the child or the teenager that has autism come to the beach, and we all interact with the stand, and a lot of them, we give swimming lessons, and watching everybody learning to do these activities really brings everybody together and makes us a unity of wanting to help each other to actually be better parents and be better people around people that do have autism, because we will understand it better. So that's the whole thing, is to understand and to give awareness.
And what do you think is the biggest misconception when it comes to autism?
I would say that everyone thinks that somebody has autism is not smart, or they think that they are handicapped, and that's not the way it is at all. You know, we all have different gifts, and just because you are dyslexic, or you have autism, or you have a birth defect, or you have ADHD, it really comes down to, we all have special gifts. And just like different color skins, you know, it doesn't even matter, because we're all different in our own in unique way. And just because somebody's a little different does not mean that they are not capable of learning a language or even going to college. So, you know, I never put anything past anybody. Like, say, in my studies, I would say, you know, if somebody said, I want to be a doctor, and they had maybe a disability, I said, well, go try your best and go for it. And you might change your mind. You know, you might end up being a nurse, or you might be a doctor. You know, you kind of go with the flow and always encourage. You encourage them all. So I would say, you never want to say the child or the teenager can't do what they want to do in life, because they are going to find, maybe they start off wanting to do this and they end up doing this because they like that better. So you never label anybody, because everything's possible. I don't doubt anything anymore. You know, I have an open mind.
And what I'm hearing is, don't label people and don't put limits to what they can be, just because you think in your mind that they cannot do that.
Exactly. And you know what? That's not our fault, because we were taught that. Because generations and generations were taught that. And what's happened is, we have to break these generations of teaching that are not correct. And you know what? I'll tell you this. This will be the perfect example. My dad was sitting next to a fellow when he was in school, and the child was a left-handed. He wondered why was his left hand. Well, the teacher would walk by him and hit him with a ruler on his left hand. Every time he picked up the pencil to try to write something with his left hand, she would hit him on the hand to stop doing it. It was not good that everybody had to write right-handed. Now, that's really not a very good thing. Can you see the difference of what's happened through, you know, generations and generations? It's okay to be left-handed, but back then, you were actually disciplined for being left-handed. So, you know, what I'm saying is, being open-minded. Somebody might write with their mouth. Somebody might write with their right hand to communicate. Somebody might do this. Somebody might do that. We should let people communicate the way that they feel most comfortable. End of story on that one. That's, you know, let people communicate the best the way they can on how, what makes them feel comfortable. You know, people will always be, you know, they'll grow up because their parents or maybe their teachers have this in their mind that they're not able to reach this destination that they want to go And I would say this, being in a parent or a teacher, never limit or label anyone of doing anything that they're doing and what they want to do in life.
And also I'm hearing don't be judgmental and be more accepting.
Exactly. Accepting and don't judge and help them on their journey. That's part of life is we all should help each other on our journey.
So this show is about leadership. And I was wondering, since you are a leader in your own right, are there any traits that leader needs to have to be a truly successful leader?
The traits I think would be best is integrity, honesty, open communication, knowledge of what you're going to be teaching or sharing. Also, you would need to be compassionate and understanding and pretty much a general good person, treat people with kindness and respect and dignity.
I really like that you mentioned that in order to be a good leader, you have to be a good communicator. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
A good communicator is someone that asks questions and they listen and they take notes. And then what they might do is have another meeting after they read exactly what happened. And if it is a situation on bullying, I was just, you know, collecting the information and gathering all the information and then come up with a good plan strategy to diffuse it and get both parents happy with the plan.
So what you're saying to us is it is very important to listen and to take good notes and then go over the notes that you took so that you can ensure that what you have and what you understood is actually what the other person has communicated to you.
Right. I think it's very important just to listen and take notes. And then, you know, after evaluating the meeting, come and have another meeting and come up with a good plan strategy on how to correct it.
Do you think that great leaders are also a good managers?
Oh, absolutely. I think leadership falls right into management because management is the same thing. You are actually managing people that you are around. Mm-hmm. And you will delegate activities to different people and ask certain people to do certain things so that your team works well together. And so I think absolutely you have to be a good leader to be a good manager.
And you mentioned something very interesting about teamwork. And I was wondering, how does a good manager and a good leader position his or her team for a success?
Well, actually, what they need to do is have a plan of action way before they become a manager. And usually by doing a certain routine and you stay in the certain routine and you have the same people doing the same activity, so they network, like say it's in a restaurant and they're the manager. So this person is doing this and this person is doing that. Everybody knows what they're supposed to be doing so that all the jobs get done and then you have a wonderful result. So yes, I think it's very important that you delegate and that you expect that person to do their job after you ask them to do it. And that way, everybody knows what their position is and what their requirements are for their position.
So what you're also saying is that besides delegating, is that one needs to have a clarity to what he or she is delegating.
Exactly. Because a lot of managers does not express exactly what that person is supposed to be doing and what the objective is and what the whole plan of action is. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they need to communicate with them openly. Mm-hmm. And each one needs to know, you know, what the other one is doing. So there's no misunderstanding.
Mm-hmm. And this leads me to my next question. Sometimes projects fail and sometimes teams don't succeed. Do you think that if team fails to do the project successfully, that is managers or leaders' fault, or that's actually on team
I believe that the manager is not at fault. As long as the manager has expressed exactly what they are required to do, and if they didn't do the job, then it is on them. That's part of their job. But if they physically can't do it and they mentally can't do it, they should never have been put in that position in the first place. So there's two results to that. If the person accepted the job and he knew what his requirements were and he was physically, mentally, and able to do them and he didn't do them, it is the hiree. It's not the manager's fault. So, no, I don't think it's at all any, you know, as long as the manager said, hey, you're supposed to do this task, and you didn't get the job done and you had plenty of time to do it and you are out on your iPhone and doing this and doing that and you aren't doing your job, absolutely. They should be fired, and it's not the manager's fault. It's the person that didn't do the job right.
So this leads me to my next question. Sometimes we have conflict in the workplace. What are your thoughts on conflict in the workplace?
Oh, absolutely. If there are two people that are conflicting, usually it's just two. That's the average. What you do is you have a one-on-one meeting and you try to work it out with the two. And if you can't work it out, then you're going to have to separate them and move them into another position or another place in the company. Or maybe you might end up having to fire both of them. It depends on what the issue is, how severe it is, and what the priority is.
Any thoughts on generosity and leadership?
Oh, now that's interesting. If you want to be generous and you are a leader, like say you're a manager or whatever, and you see somebody that has done a very, very good job, and you see this person is really doing his job up above what you ever expected, I believe in bonuses. I believe in letting them have extra days off for vacation. All of that, it is a you're giving that person a reward, for doing such a good job. And then, you know, a little icing on the cake, I think that's okay.
And what are your thoughts on staying humble while you're leading others?
Staying humble is very important, because being humbled, you're able to manage people a lot better, because you can actually see yourself doing what they're doing. And then you can have better understanding if they need help on certain events or a certain situation, or they come to you. So being humble is very important in being a good leader. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. And how does media affect the leader?
The media is usually really good about helping a leader, depending on what the subject is. The media, as long as you give the correct information to the media and everything is broadcasted perfectly and everything goes okay, yes, I think it's wonderful that the media can help anybody in management. And I think it's a wonderful thing. I've always enjoyed talking to the media, you know, especially if I know what I'm talking about.
And do you ever have concerns about fake news and how that might impact your leadership?
Well, that's a good question. On fake news, it's kind of like you don't really know if it's fake or it's reality. You have to take it as the truth at first, and then if it's later on not the truth, it'll come out. So, you know, basically that's the way you look at the media, is you're going to take them as they're telling their side of the story. But, you know, it's like that little game that you played in school where one person whispered something in somebody's ears and it went around 30 different times. And then all of a sudden it's a totally different message, that game. You know, it was like Sally went to the park, and then after four or five different people heard it, Sally was at the movie theater. So, you know, that's how news kind of gets, I guess, called fake or not reality. So it's just that people, as they talk, maybe the communication or they didn't hear it correctly, you know, it often will get
turned around or mistaken.
So do you believe that that can negatively impact one leadership style?
Yes, absolutely. I do believe it can affect, and the media can affect. I think the internet can affect perception of what people think. And absolutely, if you are said to be doing something that you're not, and it goes through the media, yes, it can be very damaging to your reputation. So yes, the media is very important. It's important for them to get the facts straight and to get the news out within a reasonable time.
And what is the most difficult part of being a leader?
I would say the most difficult part of being a leader is you're going to have to stand your ground, especially if you make rules. There's a certain rule, and you've made this rule, you don't change it just because you like this person better than that person. You've got to keep the same rules, and you've got to be consistent. And I think that can be an issue with a lot of leaders, too.
So what you're saying to us is standing your ground is very important once you laid out the rules.
Right.
And do you feel that being assertive helps you lead people better?
Assertiveness is a wonderful skill used in a proper way of kindness. You can ask somebody to do something. Would you mind asking, you know, instead of directly demanding something? So the way you ask and your projection of asking it in a positive way, assertiveness is wonderful.
So, Carlie, what would be the ways to deal with employees that are not happy with the leader?
Well, actually, if it was like, say, there were two or three leaders, you would have another leader pull the employee to the side and ask them if they could talk for, you know, a few minutes and ask them what is bothering them. And if it's something that can be corrected, is it a personal problem that they're not able to focus on the job or the event or the situation at hand? Do they need to take a leave of absence because they are sick or distressed or disturbed or have something going on, you know, that they're not able to focus on their job? And that would be the best way to handle that. And there's so many outcomes of that situation, as you know, because it could be something at home. Because what we do is we carry our emotions with us, you know, whatever's going on in our homes. And that's just a part of life. And that's part of how our genetic makeup is we do carry on our emotions of what's going on in the home place and et cetera. So that would be the best way, I would say, in my opinion, to handle that way, that situation.
So what I'm hearing you saying that the leader needs to be highly sensitive to what the employee is going through in his or her life so that he can determine the right course of action to help an employee be successful.
Absolutely.
In what they do.
You said it perfectly. That is exactly how you have to talk to them and determine what is bothering them. Because a lot of times things wouldn't bother them if there wasn't another situation going on, like say at the home place or at another job, or maybe another person is bullying them, or maybe they just don't feel well and they're sick. They could just be ill. So you would have to determine what it is, and then you'd evaluate it and then come with problem solving together, and would make them feel good too. You can even ask them, what do you want to clear up, or what do you want to change, or what is bothering you? And it might be just something very easy. They might be ill and not feeling well, and they need to go home and take a rest for 3 or 4 days and just take the day off. But some people are very workaholics and they don't do that. You know, they just keep going and going and going and not taking that time off that they need.
So I know that you collaborate with a lot of people that come from very diverse backgrounds. And I was wondering, what are your thoughts on being culturally sensitive while engaging or leading others?
You really do need to be sensitive, because there's so many different individuals and there's so many belief systems out there. And it's like language. We're all so unique. And we're like, one person might speak this language and another speaks that language. And so, and you might not have the correct understanding when you're speaking. And you can even have that with people that have accents. I mean, I've even
been to like New Orleans, and they have a very Cajun French accent because the French, you know, were settling there. So the language barrier could be an issue. And you need to, if you have to have an interpreter or have somebody come in that would help mediate the meeting, I believe that that would help a lot. And I really believe that that is probably the number one reason why we have conflict, is because our language is so different. And even if English, there's several different types of English that are spoken. And even if you speak Spanish, there are several different, you know, variations. And same with every other language. Actually, you have a break in communication that way. I believe sitting face-to-face instead of like texting makes a big difference, because you're being able to express when you're talking with the tone of your voice, you know, laughing, joking, and making the person feel comfortable, you know, versus if it's just something in writing, a lot of times you might miswrite something, and so the communication gets broken down.
Nice. So what you're saying to us, that sometimes it's really important not to only to speak to people, but also to be face-to-face so that you can actually make that visual connection with them.
That is so true. I'm not fluent in Spanish, but I can understand it. But I can get so much from us looking at each other and pointing and using hand gestures to get our communication through, you know, mm-hmm. versus on the phone. You can't get that, you mm-hmm. know, and you can't get that through texting or emailing. So face-to-face is the best way to communicate.
So what I'm hearing also is that body language comes very strongly in play when we are communicating with another person.
Absolutely. Body language is so important, and your gestures and all of that is very, very crucial in our communication and developing a better communication system.
What are your thoughts on working with a diverse group of people, and why is it so important?
I'm going to relate this to like a pageant system. You have the women from all different countries. Everyone is trying to communicate and work together. And it's very interesting because you can learn so much from talking the women. So being together and in like a group and learning from each other in a diversified group, mm-hmm. you end up learning so much more, and you end up helping each other and actually problem solving. So coming from different backgrounds and different educations, I believe that you can unite and all kinds of things you can do together. But it's a wonderful thing.
And I'm also hearing that collaborating with diverse groups, that also is very important, right?
Yes. You have to have a trusting type of group. Mm-hmm. To come together, and you come together for a special purpose, and then you can actually learn so much from each other. So yes, I think a diversified group is a wonderful way of solving all kinds of problems and become a more unified planet, and don't let anything separate us from gaining more knowledge from each other.
Mm-hmm. You are a parent, and I was wondering how parenting is connected to leadership.
Well, yeah, that's a good question. But you know what? And everyone's got to go, oh, does she have a team? But anyway, you know, because you have different stages of leadership when you are a parent. When you're first a parent and you have a toddler, you take care of them every minute of every moment, every second of the day. You feed them, you dress them, you clean them, you bathe them. And then you go through another stage of life when they become, you know, like in the teens. And, you know, they begin to feel more confident and they want to be in their own teenage groups, which is fine. And then being a parent, what you want to do is you want to be the best role model during all their years and get involved with everything that is positive in their life and promote that. Like if they want to go and be a ballerina, you know, you go and take them, put them in lessons and stuff like that. Or if they want to play basketball or whatever their sport is, you know, be supportive and make friends with the other mothers and the other fathers. And you always want to say confident things to your child. Mm-hmm. And through your love and the love of what you want to do, you can do anything in this world at any moment. Mm-hmm. And if you always seek out the goodness and try to be the helpful to people around you, you will raise above and you will actually learn so much that it'll be overwhelming to you. So I would give parents to always be thankful for what they have, to be knowledgeable in what they want to do, and to handle conflict. Raising your voice is not going to get you anywhere. Mm-hmm. Talk to them, you know, logically, and you say, you know, this is going to get you that way. And you also do have discipline, too. Discipline is very important because they need to know if they do this, their consequences are going to be that. And that will keep them on a good path to be successful in life. No life is perfect on this planet. And if we just know that we can just do the best that we can with what we have and be happy where we are right today and be glad the next day that maybe we can be a little bit better. Mm-hmm. I believe that we have choices, and the choices we make determine how our children will turn out. So you have to be the best role model possibly and just have faith that it will all work out.
Carlie, what is your mission in life?
I will say my first priority mission is every day I'm here on the planet, I want to spread kindness, consideration, love. I want to show dignity, and I want to help others that are having difficulties. I want to steer people in the right direction. I want to be a good advisor. I will say this, every day that I'm here on this planet, if I can help someone or if I can better somebody else's situation, that is my main objective.
Any final thoughts?
Well, I would like to say, being in a leadership position, you try to be very positive and do wonderful duties and help educate the public in all areas. To be humble, to be kind and generous, to be honest and trusting, help others, and to always seek knowledge.
And how can people get in contact with you?
You can get in contact with me through my email address, and it is Miss Florida America 2018 at AOL.com.
Thank you, Carlie, for being a guest on our show.
Well, thank you so much for having me. It was such an honor and thrill, and I was so excited that I was able to have this conversation and share some of my viewpoints with you guys. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for tuning in and listening to the Leadership with Biana Kovic show. Remember that you're all leaders in your own rights, and the impact that you're meant to achieve starts with small acts of kindness, curiosity, and generosity. Please give us a like and subscribe to our channel. Thank you again, and until next time.